This is concerning the Arelma case involving ill-gotten wealth of your family of at least $40 million in bearer bonds invested by the Panamanian corporation Arelma in Merrill Lynch in New York.
Okay.
The Philippine government petitioned to get it back, but you filed a petition in 2009 in New York, also later before the Supreme Court here, to stop it. According to the World Bank, it is still pending. Now that you are the president representing the Philippine government with the Solicitor General and the PCGG under you, which side will you represent, Mr. President? Will you fight yourself so that the Philippine government that you now represent can finally get it for the Filipino people?
You know, it's hard for me to answer. You clearly know more about the case than I do. I really haven't looked at it in years. And I would advise you to talk to the lawyers that are handling it, because I'm not being specious or anything like that. Matagal ko nang hindi narinig yung pangalan na Arelma. We were still in Hawaii when we were hearing that name. So we haven't really been attending to it. The previous cases that were filed post 1986, I have not touched. I have nothing. It would be highly improper for me to involve myself in that. Besides, I don't have the time to do it, so I leave it to the lawyers.
Follow-up question, please.
Yes.
Raisa.
The Philippine government is already compensating martial law, human rights victims under your father's rule. Why have you resisted issuing an apology for atrocities committed during martial law under your father's rule? And will you continue doing so as the president?
Well, I don't think it is a duty for a president to be involved. That is a personal matter for the Marcos family.
You are a member of the Marcos family.
Definitely, but it's more, my role as president is more important right now than my role as a member of the Marcos family. So I take that, that's my first priority.
So will you apologize as president of the republic in behalf?
That seems highly a little contrived. No? Who is apologizing to whom now?
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Raisa. May we have Ms. Karen Lema of Reuters, please?
Good afternoon, Mr. President. Thank you once again for being with us today.
Thank you.
Mr. President, your government has been saying that this is related to the South China Sea, my question, particularly on oil and gas exploration. Your government has said that it was prepared to guarantee, and I quote, unimpeded and peaceful exploration of all natural resources within the EEZ and other areas where we have jurisdiction. Mm-hmm. May I ask, how does your government plan to accomplish that, and what will that entail?
That's a fairly sensitive question, because let me categorize those areas that are ripe or that we are looking at for exploration. There are those who are in non-conflict areas. That's what we defined. That's what we term them as now: the conflict areas and non-conflict areas. And as far as the Philippines is concerned, if those prospective reserves are within the EEZ, conflict area or otherwise, then any exploration should be conducted by the Philippines. So if that, however we choose to do it, if we choose to do it by ourselves, if we choose to do it in partnership with other corporations, or which will probably be the case, because we don't have the capacity for that very large scale heavy engineering in terms of exploration, but how that's going to be done? Because in our case in the Philippines, it is really not a matter of choice. Let me take it back a couple of steps. In the Philippines, we are presently trying to shift our mix of power generation from fossil fuels away from fossil fuels towards renewables. Now, that doesn't happen in an instant. You do not flick a switch and you are suddenly all renewable. You have a transition period, which is turning out to be much more complicated than everyone thought. But anyway, in the Philippines, we have decided that LNG is going to be our transition fuel. And that is why it is imperative for the Philippines to now examine and to see to guarantee the supply of LNG to our country so that we have sufficient power. Because it's not enough that we maintain the levels of power generation that we have now. Well, with all the plans that we have, essentially to industrialize the Philippines, it's essentially to enter into the digital space, all of these things require a great deal of power. And so it is important to the Philippines that we explore those reserves and see exactly what there are and how we go about exploiting them and bringing that gas supply to the Philippines. So we are doing our best. I think we will, of course, to keep it simple. Prevailing term these days is pick the low hanging fruit. So the low-hanging fruit will be those reserves that are within our EEZ that are not in a conflict area. We'll attend to that first, and then we'll see what else that we can do. We need them all, though. We need them all. Even if we do well with the non-conflict areas reserves, we still have to look at all the others, whether they be in conflict areas or otherwise.
Follow up, please.
Just a follow-up, Mr. President.
Very quick.
Has progress been made on the oil and gas talks between the Philippines and China? Last year, if I'm not mistaken, both countries have agreed to resume oil and gas talks. So has progress been made? If yes, why? And if no, then why not?
Well, we always come up against the same argument or between China and the Philippines, because when we say that we would like to explore, they insist that these areas are in Chinese territory and therefore Chinese law must prevail. We, of course, do not accept that. We say this is Philippine territory and therefore Philippine law should prevail. That's really where the sticking point is. Even before I came into office, that was already the situation we've been. I hear a great many optimistic reports that they're saying that we have agreed, we've come to an agreement, but I haven't really seen something that we can work, that we can use to work forward. In other words, I don't really think we have a proper agreement, and it really comes down to that issue. Which law will apply? And the reason that there is an argument is that China claims that these territories belong to China. We dispute that, and that's where the problem is.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
May we have Ms. Joanna Balearan of GG Press, please.
Joanna Balearan from GG Press. Sir, my question is about Japan and the Reciprocal Access Agreement. So when will the Philippines and Japan sign the agreement? And can you please give us a time frame?
For
the RAA, sir.
For the?
RAA, the Reciprocal Access Agreement with Japan.
The Reciprocal. We're working on that. Yes. That will be coming soon. We spoke about it again with Prime Minister Kishida when I was in Washington. There aren't any real conflicts in principle. It's just a question of getting the language down and defining precisely how it's going to work, the logistical systems and how that's going to work. But it should not take very much longer. I think we're very close to completion on that.
Okay, sir. Just a follow-up. Sure. Filipino comfort women who are still seeking World War II justice and reparations are raising concerns about the RAA. How do you ensure that this agreement doesn't compromise the country's interests? And which country do you think should take custody of Japanese soldiers committing crime on Philippine soil?
I cannot see how the reciprocal agreement would affect any of that. It essentially talks about Japan allows us to make ports of call in Japan and vice versa. How it will possibly affect the issue about comfort women and the what allegations that are made against war criminals during the Second World War. I cannot see how it will bleed into that. I think it's quite distinct and discreet in its effect.
About the custody, sir.
About the
custody
of
erring Japanese servicemen on Philippine soil. Which country do you think should take custody of these Japanese servicemen in case RAA is approved?
Oh. It's not the same as a visiting forces agreement. That's not similar. The visiting forces, we've had problems with that with the Americans, some American forces, as we all know. It's very, very different from what the reciprocal agreement will be with the Japanese. It's not going to be as if it's their base and their seamen will come down and will go into the city and go into. Well, I don't think that that's a part of the agreement.
Thank you
so much. May we have Mara Cepeda of the Straits Times, please?
Hello, Mr. President.
Hello.
Sir, you already reiterated the position of the Philippines regarding the ICC.
Yes.
And so, sir, I raised the issue of the Philippines advocating for an international rules-based order. We're pushing for it when we are resisting Beijing's aggressive actions against the Philippines in the West Philippine Sea. But we are opting out of the Rome Statute when an adverse case has been lodged against us. So, sir, is the rules-based order only applicable to the Philippines when it's convenient for us?
What is the rule about the ICC? When do they adopt jurisdiction? They adopt jurisdiction in a country, or they have jurisdiction in a country when no judicial system is working, is functioning. No police no police force is functioning. In other words, that probably there is war, and none of these issues about war crimes and all of this are being attended to, simply because the administration, especially in the judiciary, especially in law enforcement, are not functioning. That is the reason why we are saying we are well within the rules. It is their rule. It is the rule of ICC that they come in when there is no judiciary. They come in when there is no police force. We have a judiciary. The Chief Justice, the former Chief Justice, sitting right here. He will explain to you how healthy and robust and active the judiciary is. The police force, I think, the same thing. So that is the reason. It is not. We are well within international law when we take the position of not recognizing the jurisdiction of ICC in the Philippines.
Mm-hmm. One follow-up, sir. So yeah. if the ICC issues an arrest warrant against former President Duterte, will the Philippine government hand him over?
Will we do what?
Will the Philippine government hand him over if the ICC...
We don't recognize the warrant that they will send to us.
So that's a no?
That's a no.
Thank you, sir.
Regine Cabato of the Washington Post, please.
Good afternoon, Mr. President. Last week, you said that you were horrified at the prospect of a gentleman's agreement between former President Duterte and China.
Wouldn't you be?
Of course.
I think we all should, right?
Mm-hmm. And you said as well, Mr. President, that he should be held accountable. And since then, experts have said that any such agreement compromising PH sovereignty or territory would be a violation of not just the 2016 arbitral ruling, but Philippine law. So my question for you, sir, is how do you intend to hold former President Duterte accountable? Are there any actions being taken on this front?
Well, we're we still have to find out what it is all about. We cannot. I've tried to get in touch with former officials of the previous administration who could possibly have been involved in these discussions. And I have to tell you, I haven't gotten a straight answer out of anyone. Now, one party says, one person says there's no agreement. Another person says, no, there was talk, but it's only status quo. No, there was, and another one will say, there was an agreement. So I'll go back to the three questions that I asked when this came, when this subject came up. Number one, the first question I want answered is, was there an agreement in fact? I think by now we can see that in fact there was a secret agreement, and the what verifies that and what I think for me at least convinces me that there was in fact a secret agreement is the insistence of the Chinese government that there was a secret agreement. I do not think the Chinese government, I don't think Beijing will just make up and just out of nowhere say there was a secret agreement when there was no such thing. All right, so I think to my mind that is sufficient to me to prove to me that there was such an agreement. The second question I need answered is, what is contained in that secret agreement? What did we agree to? And why did we agree to them, to that? What exactly is it that we compromised? Number two. Number three, and this is a critical question, why did you keep it secret? Why is there not one single document that contains that agreement? Why is there not one shred of evidence that can show that this agreement exists? Why, when we the transition period between the previous administration to this administration, did no one mention a secret agreement? Why was it kept secret? These are very simple questions, but I'm finding a great deal of difficulty finding answers for them. Because I hear one thing and another thing and another thing and another thing, it's all very maraming palusot. In other words, I don't know how to translate that in English, but maraming palusot.
Let me add a fourth question to that, Mr. President. What happens if you find out that there might be a legal liability on the part of former President?
I cannot see how there could possibly be a legal liability. There is no evidence of any agreement.
Okay.
Is there a document that is signed? I'd love to see it. Mm-hmm. You know, it does not affect the Philippines. And if there is, I have said that before, when this first came up a few months ago, and they said it turns out that the Chinese are insisting that there's a secret agreement, and perhaps there is. And I said, I don't know anything about the secret agreement. Should there be such a secret agreement, I am now rescinding it. So I've rescinded it, if indeed it exists. We are so far from getting to the truth, to the nub of the thing. We are so far away from it yet that it's very hard to give a reaction to those questions. Let's get those three questions answered. We've answered the first one. Now, What is contained in that secret agreement, and why was it kept secret? Those are the two questions left. Once we get those three answers, real answers, then we will know what to do.
Just a quick follow-up, Mr. President. You also said last week that you found the silence of Vice President Sara Duterte understandable, even as her family members have attacked you lately. And some analysts have even said that the family is out to undermine your policy. How would you describe your relationship with the Duterte family currently? And how would you reconcile your continued allyship with the Vice President and her family's vocal disdain for your policy?
It's complicated.
Okay.
All right. It's complicated. But if you ask about the one, of course, that I have the most contact with is Inday Sara. And how we were with each other during the campaign, after the election, it hasn't really changed. Yun nga, that's what she always says. She said, oh, are you all right? You're in the middle of all of this. And she says, no, I'll just work. Don't worry about it. I'll just work and work and work and work.
All right. That's her attitude. All right. Thank you so much for answering very candidly, Mr. President.